Welcome to The Consider Show, exclusive interviews with entrepreneurs in cannabis and non-related cannabis industries that explores minds of those that are expressing their realities on common social problems and business opportunities that they have experienced in life. Offering solutions to those that tune in to what is being said, that they are helping others guide themselves by sharing the power is within. So sit back and relax and listen. It is in the process, not the event. I am that I am. Some call me Haru. Date February 4th, 2016. Consider exclusive interview with guest Jeannie420. Jeannie420, welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you very much, Haru.
Yeah, so introduce yourself to the world. What is so, you know, your uniqueness? What is some of your uniqueness?
Well, as you know, my name is Jeannie420. That's what I'm known as, and that is what I go by. And the reason I'm Jeannie420 is because who doesn't want a genie who's also a cannabis genie? Mm. I mean, if I was going to make a wish, I would not only want a genie, I'd want it to be a cannabis genie too. Cannabis is magical to me. What it has done in the short amount of time that it's been in my life, because I was never a fan.
Okay.
Never a fan. I hated it. I couldn't think of anything worse than being lazy, sitting around eating. Oh my God. It's the worst, the last thing I would ever want is something that made me want to eat. The moment that I realized it gave me munchies and it made me lazy, that was it. I lost all that. We had one date and that was it.
Wow.
I never went back. And then it would be many years later that I would end up, I was always sick. I always had something going on with me. I'm adopted and I had a very weak immune system and I had a lot of fighting to do. I was always a survivor. But I would have periods where I would be like, I would get a bronchitis and then something else would hit me and then I would have an accident and I came into this world literally kicking and being drugged, kicking and screaming, like I should say, because I was adopted. I was brought kind of against my will because I really didn't want to leave where I was at, even though it wasn't the greatest of conditions. When you're a child, before you know,
yes.
And so I had to get used to this though because I was adopted multiple times and people ask me all the time about my accent and I can't tell you because the thing is, I don't know. I speak this way because this is who I was around, this is what influenced me, and then I'm around people that do speak English all day long. Because really, the only time I'm around people that speak English are my inner family, you know, and the ones that I can, like, scold enough to get to speak English. But when I'm around my friends long enough, then I sound just like them. So don't get on me about my accent, that's the first thing. And the same thing is that, like I said, it came to me late in my life, and I was extremely sick. This time around, I didn't know what was going on with me. I was barely in my chest, in my late teens. And I had always got married early. I got emancipated at 16. I got married at 17. I didn't want to, but just the way life sometimes turns out. And I was already divorced. I already had thought that I found my life career at 19. And you can ask who that is.
Sure.
What was my life career? It was to be a solid girl dancer.
Wow.
And to be a side attendant. I thought that was the rock star role. That's all it really was. And then I went to the International Air Academy here in Vancouver, Washington. And I was saying negative, but I can tell you that it's just not as it appears.
Wow.
heartbroken. They're 19. You know, my life is over. I've already been married. I've already had a baby. I'm barely 19 years old. And I just thought, well, I'm me. And what else do I do? Because when your dream was to do that, and then that's no longer your dream.
Sure.
And then life just kept handing me more curveballs. And one day, I was in the midst of like a whole lot of emotional turmoil for the past, my boyfriend, I had all kinds of things. And I woke up and I was feeling all the physical, all the emotional, you know, going all with me, but my gums were bleeding. Like,
wow,
bad.
Wow.
Like, bad, bad. Like,
that's crazy.
Bleeding to the point where it was so noticeable. And I went and I was brushing my teeth and the sink just filled up with blood. And then my hair started falling out. And I had hair down to my waist.
Wow.
I'm 19. Yeah. I mean, you know.
Young, too. That's young.
And I'd been sick off and on, off and on, had all these accidents, so I finally reached a place where my body had found health and grew and bloomed and was blossoming, and then all of a sudden it was like I was just dismantling and I didn't know what was happening. It was early 1980s. We had not heard of the disease AIDS yet.
Okay.
But it was really intense. Around the time that my symptoms were showing, I was a huge social butterfly at 19 years old. I had been in bands. That's why I got emancipated. I have been singing in a band since 16 years old, or
okay.
Trying to sing in a band. Mm-hmm. Trying, rather, I'll say.
Mm-hmm.
And I had severe anxiety issues and
wow.
Social issues. And had I known about medicine then, I would have turned out to be a completely different person.
I'm sure.
But thank God for it, because I also wouldn't be here today without it. And that was the one to say that I became extremely sick. The symptoms came on very rapidly, and people just didn't know what to think. Socially, they thought, oh God, you have AIDS. You have something horrible. And I had everybody parted. Like, no, I could dial 1,000 people on my speed dial, because I was on the radio, it's on KPD.
Sure.
I was a nanny, and I was on KPD at my time, doing okay. Naughty teenage dominatrix thing. We'll talk about that another time altogether. And I was getting sick, and I thought God was punishing me. I thought, oh, I've done it. I've got too naughty. I've gone, you know, I've been bad, naughty, and I've been stricken with some horrible disease.
Yes.
And when this wasn't letting up, and my long 24-inch length hair from my neck, my neck, my own, was falling out in clumps. Bleeding, and I wasn't even eating. I would be drinking water and I could taste blood. And there was this metallic, this weird metallic taste in my mouth all the time. I couldn't explain what was happening to me.
Wow.
I felt like something had taken over, and it was just in every part of my body, and I didn't know what was going on. And it would be years of misdiagnoses and years of my being told, oh, and then eventually you get to the only diagnosis you can get to, and that's the C word. And once they, I'd already been going to radiation ever since I came to America. I
think, oh, okay,
okay.
Wow, that's pretty
great. So I've been being blasted with radiation every year, like on schedule. Oh, hurry, it's time for radiation.
Wow,
and I, around 10, I knew that something was seriously wrong with it mentally. And all this moving back and forth from America and back to my country was leaving me out of school. I would have to restart, re-begin, re-go. And because of my tuberculosis, sometimes I wouldn't get a pass to come to America. And I would have to stay another year or another few months until I could get a visa to come back. So I already was quite familiar with pills and being sick and being in the system, if you
sure,
will.
Sure.
And I had one brilliant binge. I was treated like a rock star when I would go to the hospital. And when I first was bedridden and sent in for ongoing care, I was treated like I was, I mean, like a rock star, you know, like I had money, but I didn't have insurance. But once that started waning and my disease started progressing and my symptoms started staying, and no matter what they started doing, it wasn't responding. So it wasn't Crohn's, it wasn't Sprue, it wasn't irritable bowel, it wasn't a myriad of things that you hear every single day. You know, don't take this, it causes that, don't cause this, because it'll do that. Well, I also have a lot of toothache, because I've been losing so much bone, and I was taking a leave, and I was doing it just like prescription said, taking every 6 hours, and goodness knows, when you have a toothache, you need ongoing painkiller.
For sure, or something. You need something.
Oh, yeah. It's the one thing that men and women can go, that is the closest thing to having labor, darling.
Oh, yeah, wow.
That's the closest you will ever feel to us being on the same pain level, a man and a woman. And it's excruciating. And I had suffered an accident, which made it worse. So I had all kinds of trauma and pain in my face. And I was taking this every 6 hours, thinking that it was alleviating some pain,
okay,
but it was also causing my liver and my kidneys to bleed.
Oh, wow.
Severe. Yeah, and if you read it says in very fine print, and I love how they do that because it's targeted the elderly, and you know that they're not going to pull out their glasses every time and read.
And you was young. You was super young, too.
Yeah, they're not going to sit there and read 6 pages of what it's going to do to you before you can take it to alleviate something. So my doctor immediately asked me 3 things. Do you drink Diet Coke or Pepsi? And do you take a leave? Those are 2 key things that he asked me. And I found that interesting that immediately you would come to those conclusions. And, well, I can give you a myriad of horrible things about the Diet Coke and Pepsi, especially the women, and the false breast test that they were giving. And so I was being blessed and cursed at the same time, if you will, because while there was something going on in my body, it gave me a unique result in that it stimulated my breast. I was a 19-year-old girl. So they started growing and growing and growing. And soon I had triple D's on my hands. But I was really desperate being sick. I know. Thanks for the present, but I can't open it. And immediately my doctor said, there, we need to start doing a biopsy there. And they started scarring and marring and taking me apart. Oh, it was horrific. And it was nothing I could do because I want to live. And then years, months go by, and I'm telling you, it was horrible. And then I got misdiagnosed for 2 years. I was a part-time worker. I gave up my teenage job matrix job, and I went full-time to NCI, when it used to be around as a long-distance company.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, AT&T would tell you they were the bad guys. Naughty AT&T. They were the bullies on the block. So bad. So I thought, well, God's punishing me for being naughty, so I'll take a regular job, I'll take 6 jobs. I'll do whatever I have to cleanse myself. So I was doing my penance, and I'll tell you, you get adopted one time by a Catholic family, and that's it.
Wow.
So my doctor, I worked part-time, and then I stayed on, and I was very sick, but I finally made it to a full-time employee. 90 days is the thing.
Okay.
I finally made it, and I had a female doctor looking at me, and I thought, thank God, I'm going to get some relief. And she just looked at me, and she would write things down and ask me questions and look at me so suspiciously. I was starting to feel like I had a relationship with her, like my mom for a minute there. I was starting to confess things that I shouldn't be telling her. But she would look at me, and she would just write things down. The nurse at the front counter was actually more concerned with me than this doctor was. And
okay.
She kept suspecting that I had an eating disorder.
Oh, wow.
So she refused to do any real blood tests or any type of, you know, she's just doing this to herself, basically, type attitude. And every time I'd come in drinking a Diet Coke or a Pepsi, she would just shake her head, you know, give me that look, that parental look of disgust, and then she would start my session.
Wow.
And she, for two full years, ignored all my symptoms, ignored all my cries, ignored all the emotional turmoil I was going through. And then when they were talking C-word with me, they said, it's super important that we discuss how emotional your life has been lately, because cancer is very emotional.
Yes.
They're emotional. Yes. And yes. It's important that when we do start treating you with radiation again, that this time we have to keep your mood up, and you've been very depressed lately, where you fight with depression. So we're going to have to do something to give you some more mood altering. So out of the 27 ingredients that they were already pumping into me through an intravenous tube,
wow,
they are now going to assess some more that they can
add to the add to the problem.
And I know that this is a lifestyle for some people. I know that I, well, they told me if I made it to 24, imagine this, if you make it to 24, you can have a birthday party, and you can have a full colostomy, and you can have it wrapped around your leg, and you can have that shame with the rest of your being.
Wow.
And by the way, as a bonus, you'll get a feeding tube and a morphine backpack.
Wow.
If you order now.
Wow.
Wow,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
and
good.
I remember that the worst part for me was not so much the diagnosis, the prognosis, which is your future outcome, but it was the then and the there, fighting the depression. I want to die. I mean, what purpose do I have for living at this point? And I realized in those dark moments, if you, because it's all you in the end, you yourself,
sure,
you know, everyone wants to do this. If you don't stand behind your own words, if you don't stand for something in life, if you don't have a cause or purpose, a passion, and if all those three things meet, that's beautiful. But if you don't have any of those things in your life, then you really don't have a reason to get out of bed in the morning. You don't have a reason to live for the children. If you don't have
great
those,
point.
You know, I was 19. What did I have to do? I didn't even have a future for children. I mean, I barely had a future for myself. That was going to change. So I had to really face my maker, and I had to have some really hard conversations that I wasn't ready to have. But who is? But I realized in those moments that if I made it, if God brought me back, I promised him my life and my soul. And I said, I don't know who or what you are because I've believed in you all my life, but really when it comes down to it, you were just a plastic image. And I turned to you because you had that long hair and the blue eyes, and I thought you were a rock star. I mean, you had people sitting in trees, for goodness sakes, listening to you. So you had something to say. And let's face it, Jesus is sexy. Jesus is so sexy. He didn't even have a guitar. And he had men and women following him around. Children. Lambs playing down with the lions. I mean, this guy had something going on. So no matter what, I would have been attracted to the spirit of Jesus. You know, I was only a 19-year-old. What can I say? And I never got past that. But in so many ways, I'm so blessed, and I can be nothing but grateful. So I told him in those hours, I told him true. I said, you know, I don't know where I'm going, but I'm clearly going somewhere. I'm dying, and I'm seeing light, and I've got the whole thing. I've got the lights coming and the music playing, and I know I'm going to God. And I can hear them. I'm in a coma, and I can hear them. Oh, my God. I can hear them saying, well, you know, from a monetary standpoint, this is costing. Let's just go over the facts. And they literally, I've heard this in the orphanage too, you become a liability. I mean,
sure.
In the health, let's call it care industry, I call it big pharma, is an industry, it's a business, people. And it's tied into fast food, and it's tied into groceries, and it's tied into processing. And and they call it just that. They would come to me in the hospital, and they would say, good morning, let's talk about your process. We need you to start processing your death. We need you to start accepting and processing this. And it's like, it's like school every day. You're coming in here and you're asking me to start accepting and processing. What does that
come
mean?
Come on. Come on.
And in terms that you can understand, it means that when you go into hospital, you become a patient. And what are you waiting for? You're waiting for treatment, cure, or God.
Wow.
Yeah, and you will be categorized by what I've been categorized my entire life. My class, my dignity, my money, where did I come from and who yes. do I am, blah, blah, blah.
Yes.
You are a commodity in yes. this world. Your social yes. security number is your basically your time punch.
Yes.
When you can mm. live outside of all of these things, today I'm a free woman and I'm free in every way, shape, and form because I've died. And I asked this question. I've never had a birth certificate, and I died. I died clinically for 6 minutes and 67 seconds, which is technically 7 minutes. Mm. I'm not the longest on record, mm. but I'm one of the longer ones that has complete sentences. That sure. isn't journey into a cup. That appears to have all my faculties in store. And I still have this lovely accent. They're touching my brain is doing something correctly.
Yes.
You know, because I'm still picking up on memories. I'm still picking up on training. Mm. I'm still, my brain is still clearly functioning. And the way and the means that brought me back is before they unplugged me, because I heard them talking about that too. Literally, I could be cross about this. Literally, it came down to, they were saying, you know, well, it's costing X amount of money to keep the plug going, and, you know, times are tough.
Wow.
And that this is the floor that, like, you know, our insurance is gone, and it's going to be, she's going to be a pauper soon, you know? And it's amazing how much your level of care changes when your insurance is depleting.
Yes.
And when you've gone through your social security, when you've gone through your short-term disability, and, you know, when they're no longer fighting for your case, you know. When I stopped putting sunscreen on my second husband, he knew the marriage was over.
Wow.
Yeah. I stopped putting sunscreen on him.
Yeah.
I would hand it to him. I wasn't a complete cruel person. I would hand it to him and remind him to put it on, but I wasn't immediately taking it. You know, the care wasn't there. The care wasn't, the love was gone. And in the hospital, you know when the love is gone. You know when they're thinking about parting you out. And if you were like me and you signed that card that says that you're willing to give up your organs, be careful.
Yeah, people, I mean, it's a business, like you said. It's a business.
Right. So,
you know.
This is a system. And mind you, the whole, if you look up system in the first place, the whole idea of the system is that there's a back door. Whoever designed it in the first place, of course, they're going to need keys for them to get in and out of it.
Yes.
Always think about that.
Yes. Interesting. So, how have you, what has been some of the administrative, as far as how has cannabis help you, like the tinctures? Are you really in the tinctures, edibles, the flower? What are some of them? You okay? Do your thing. I can edit this. I can pause it.
I watched the Cannabis Health Summit.
Okay, the Health Summit, okay.
Yeah, done by the Green Flower Media.
Yes.
Brilliant. Shout out to everybody that did that. Incredible. I got some amazing information. The most important thing I got from that was they were saying that the health quotient is 2.5 of CBD as well as THC.
Okay.
For your optimum health. And they were talking in terms of juicing it.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's right. You did mention that last time we talked, too. You know.
Yes, because I was living at one point with a lady who had throat cancer. She's been fighting it since 11 years old.
Wow.
And it had come back while I was living with her. And our story's even more amazing. I met her in fact. We'll get into that. I don't know the time. But she's been fighting throat cancer since she's 11. When I started living with her, she said, you know, I'm not going through chemo again. I'm not going to do it. And she said, she has an 8-year-old daughter and a young boy. She said, I want you to not tell the family. I basically, I became the nanny again. And we fought it. We did organic juicing every day. We live across the street from the farmer's market. We utilized it.
Oh, for
and
sure.
We use nothing but organic bud. Organic 100%. And
interesting.
Let me tell you, it not only demasted hives, but growth that she had on the right side of her throat, which we knew about, but we didn't know there was another one the size of 0 to 0.7. Now that's pretty significant.
That's
growing
crazy.
On the opposite side of her throat.
Wow.
We started blasting her with fresh juicing and the organic bud, and we made sure that the bone was always clean. I mean, we were fastidious about all of it.
Sure.
When we did this, we didn't get, I mean, it's medical proof. She not only got rid of the growth growing again on the, because it had grown back on the right side of her neck, but the second one was growing away as well. All I can tell you is that cannabis has worked for me, and it's worked for others I know of.
Sure.
I went from a deathbed, literally a deathbed. And like I said, it wasn't my first choice for medicine. I was so sick. And now with being nauseous every day of my life, throwing up, and now my kidneys weren't working, and they would tell me what I could look forward to, which was pretty much everything shutting down.
Sure.
And then because I had signed away my kidneys and my life, they were just waiting. I mean, just waiting at the go.
Wow.
To be able to take these things from me. But unfortunately, I had a lot of toxicity in my body, and we just didn't know what was happening to me. The real truth of what was going on with me is even more shocking than life. But what ends up happening is I end up going the route of the hospital. I sign all the papers, you know, I go into health, I volunteered in hospice, and here I was being wheeled in to hospice in the final days. And, you know, they pump you full of your medicine, they give you as much painkiller, Oxycontin, a lot of gold, I mean, dear God, 800 milligrams going into my IV.
That's crazy
amount.
Crazy.
And, yeah, and I had never, ever been a drug addict before this time. Ever. Never touched them in my lifetime. It wouldn't do them until I'm 35 years old. And mind you, again, I'm fighting for my life to make it 24. So that's a whole nother journey.
Yes.
But here I am in the hospital getting these IVs. And when they took me out and put me in the hospice, they put the tube into, anybody would recognize them, I call them the fang bites, because if you've been on life support, the tube gives you fang bites marks on you, and it's here in your chest. That's the one that's more permanent. And I, as I said, died for 6 minutes 67, and I could hear them literally saying, you know, the cord, the issue of who's going to pull that cord, and whether or not they should keep me just a minute longer, or who should revive me.
Wow.
And it's all God. It's all God and Ganja, but somehow, some way, I have one person in my corner, two people actually, one guy that I dated only four times, and then my crazy girlfriend. See, out of two human beings, out of everyone in your life, when you go to the end time, and of all the friends you ever had, and only two human beings will stand up for you, I will never say enough about them. Jake's my angel and me, my crazy friend, I love you so much. They buried me until it was hospice. She brought me to Washington thinking that I would say goodbye to my family. So what ends up happening is I take everything out.
Yeah.
I take my tubes out, I deny everything, I suppress all medications, and it was a chance, but I was dying. And I wasn't getting any better. And my friends looked at me and they said, geez, you, I mean, they were brutal, but you're dying, dude, they called me too. You're dying. And if you stay here, they're going to punch you out. And they just, you know, a friend does what a friend does. Tells you when there's broccoli in your teeth. You know, tells you.
Yes.
She's better. She's better.
Yeah, come on. Keep it real.
All of them trusted with me, right? And so she said, what do you want to do? Do you want to die here? And what do you want to do?
Yeah.
Or I said, well, why am I, what, you sound like you have an option for me. What is your option here? She said, I don't have one, but I met this guy online, and I want to meet him, and I have a chance at love, and you're dying, and I think that, I'm going to be perfectly honest with you. I've done all I can for you. You have a kid. She's in Washington. I think you should at least go say goodbye to her, and I think you should goodbye to your families, all of them, most of them are in Washington. And I'm like, why should I reach out to them? But here I am dying and no one's reaching out to me. And she's like, I know, but I just think that if it were me, and I really was, I mean, you really have to face it, if it was me and I was dying, she said to me, then I wouldn't want to die this way, and I wouldn't want to die here. And after crying and throwing things at her, I said, you know, who can I can't be mad at all time.
Yes.
So you're right. So I prayed. I did all my prayers. I watched as much Monty Python as I could. I got my spirits up as far as I could, and then I said, literally got my spirits up. And then somebody brought me the miracle medicine. The miracle medicine, they brought me a brownie. Now, I'm on an IV. I can't eat the bloody thing. So mad at them for doing it to me. But they let it melt into my mouth. Just, you know, like a baby. They said like a bird. And the love and the care and the magic of this brownie, truly magic brownie, was White Widow. A strain I'd never even heard of.
Yeah, White Widow.
I've never even heard of medical marijuana before. I'd only heard of weed. And what I knew, what I was paying for, I'm so mad. I didn't even know why were they referring to it as a flower.
Yes.
It was a bunch of brown weeds and sticks. Twigs. There's no berries. It's just twiggery. I mean, what? And when I saw, because I had nothing but time on my hands in the hospital, I'm bedridden. You know, when I'm bedridden, small hospital, and I became, so I would sit up in bed and I had nothing else to do but be turned here and there in my bed, so I would have my eyes, so I watched the telly, and I would insist that they would turn into like the learning stations for me, and then I insisted that somebody hook me up on internet, and mind you, oh my god, I'm gonna share my age, I was on I was on the computer because I was bedridden. I was on the computer back when it was MIRC, Microwave Internet Relay Chat.
Oh, wow.
And then it became IRC, and then it became ICQ, and then it became AOL.
That's when Motel 6
was Motel 4 and a half.
That's been a minute.
Right, super late was maybe super 4 or 5. And I was bedridden in, I had nothing but time on my hands. So instead of being imprisoned and crying every day, I could only do that for so long. And then I was like, well, if I'm going to go meet my maker, I'm going to learn something about him. So then I started learning all I could about every religion, everything. I couldn't limit myself to being just the drop of the jaw. I couldn't lose myself to being Catholic. That, you know, that's just who I was raised around, and the nuns just were. I mean, it's hard to throw a stick in England and not find yourself a Catholic nun, for goodness sake. So it was just, so I opened myself broader. I opened myself up to other religions, other beliefs, everything there was. And at the time, mind you, the time I was in, I was reading the Seth Chronicles, and I'm not talking Seth Green, which is ironic that I would end up there, but I'm talking about the Seth Chronicles of channeling and astral projection and all that, and it was new. People thought people were crazy talking about this stuff.
Sure.
If you're in hospital and they were talking about taking all your around your leg and parting you and changing everything about you from the inside out, you would pretty much go searching for any type of answers anywhere you could go. And so I ended up making the journey, and what gave me the strength was that brownie, that medicine entering my body. And then I didn't know, but they were slipping it into me anywhere they could. They were shutting off my IVs, they were squeezing my tubes, trying to shut down the medicine.
Wow.
My friends were really, really, really good about me.
And that's cool.
The day that they absolutely saved my life, because it started my journey. And when I got out of hospice, here I am, a drug addict. I'm so used to having painkillers, morphine, you know,
that's my heavy stuff too.
Shots. I can get a pack. I used to be able to get them every 3 hours, every 2 hours, every 1 hour, and then I could get them any time I buzzed them. Wow. Any time. They could have just given me a dose of 75 milligram Demerol. No, nothing. And I could buzz her right back. She won't even be out the door yet, and I could buzz her back. Because I'm terminal. So when you're terminal, they just try to make you uncomfortable as well.
Yeah, that's crazy.
And because they needed my buzz.
Yeah.
So yeah, they're gonna keep me around.
Yeah, like you said, the business, you know, it's a business.
The business, and, you know, the business of death, because yeah. That's what it was. It's a death business, and the business isn't over until you're buried, and then that's
exactly.
Right there. But while you're alive and dying, that's the biggest business of all.
The game. It's the big game.
Alive and dying, and so many of us people are alive and dying. Alive and dying. Let me tell you how free I am today. I not only have made it same age as the Super Bowl, I've had two children since then. Now, my son didn't make it due to violence, but my daughter did.
Mm-hmm.
Went on to cure my body, wear a mask, and I'll get to that too. And so there I was. I was used to having all these painkillers. And I have another really dark path to go through, and that's coming off of morphine.
Wow. That's huge.
And how I did that was cannabis.
Yes.
I could have never gone through anything if it was not for the beauty, the bliss, the pain relief, and just the sadness uplift. Because you will remember, I'm a super depressed person. I've been like zoomed up my entire life.
Yes.
And then on top of it, my immune system and my body and my health, and I got this huge, gorgeous body, beautiful boobs I've been asking for my whole life, and now I can't even do anything with them because they're all scarred and I've been cut, defaced. And on top of it, I have to be strong enough to live long enough to have a backpack on me for the rest of my life.
Wow.
And rely on medicine and pills. I mean, if you were in my cupboard, I had 27 prescriptions that they wanted me to be taking on a regular.
Yes, that's ridiculous.
If you were in my cupboard today, all you're going to find is more cannabis trays than a strain for the tea. But there isn't any of these. There's no Tylenol. I don't even have gummy vitamins.
Yes.
Nothing.
Yeah.
I know people that get out of bed and they sound like a bowl of cereal. They snap, crackle, and pop. I'm 50. Yeah. And I tell you, I want to be a solid girl dancer. Well, let me tell you something. I am a solid girl dancer. I am the 7 gold leaf of sativa. I am the diva of sativas. This plan brought me from bedridden. It brought me from no hope. It brought me, I swear, it brought me closer to God. And the reason is because I put all my faith and my love into a thing that I called God. And when they called it a day on me, and they said, let's call it, and it's gone, it's over, and I had no birth certificate, so here's where it gets interesting.
Yeah.
I died on their table. Who died?
Yes.
If they've never given me a birth.
Yes. True. True that.
Right. So the person all these years, the character that had the social, the girl that lived in America, that was your American entity, she had her death. She died. So you can't take social from me anymore. You can't come after me for anything anymore. And guess what? Neither can any of my nightmares. So I am now alive in this world. I am more alive than ever. I'm alive and free. And you can be too. Cannabis is the answer. God has got you. And for you how? All you have to do is ask for yourself. Because I don't have the answers for everyone. I only know what I went through. And
yes.
I know I stumbled because I never turned to it. I turned away from it. Every time somebody offered me marijuana, I was like, kid, get that away from me. Ew. I would rather have done coke, which I didn't. But I would rather have done coke than that because of the stigma
yes.
of being such a nasty. You know, ew. pills to be that. And I didn't see any benefit in it. I thought it was reefer madness all over again.
Yes.
And now today, I am the biggest. I will not, I have a potty mouth. I kind of talk about it all the time. I mean, it comes into my conversations, even if you don't want to have a conversation with me about it. I mean, I wear a necklace for goodness sakes. I wear a pipe around my neck, thank you, chronic medicine. And I keep it stuffed with a bowl at all times because safety happens.
Yes.
I hate that sentence, that ish happens. That's such a negative. I don't even like to say down anymore. I always say I'm up with that. Because this has changed my absolutely life. And it has taken me to a higher, more wonderful, more beautiful, sane place of regular balance. And I realized through the health summit that that's what they're talking about.
Yes.
The purpose of the endocannabinoid system is homeostasis. And that means perfect balance.
Yes.
If you will, it's my spirituality. It is my communion. I'm not being blasphemous when I say that. Sacrilegion is chasing the sack. It's dope. There's no hope with dope.
Yes.
That is your truth. That is where you're going to come to Jesus. Because one way or another, you're going to go to Jesus. But with this, you're going to find God. You're not just going to find Jesus. You're going to find God. You're not just going to find judgment. You're going to find your healing.
Yes.
Your health. Your well-being. And your ability to talk non-stop without having a dry mouth.
No doubt. No doubt. Great point. It's a great point. You know. I mean,
if you could see how weak, how sick, and how agile I was at one point, and you know that I've come all this way back, my health has grown, my hair has grown, my lashes, something's chemo will take away from you or change, then really,
sure.
you understand what I'm talking about, that
melanation,
you've never, once you've been taken apart, cell by cell, you never feel quite like yourself, but you know what I say? Good.
Yeah.
Let me be reborn each and every time. Let me renew. Let me play justice.
Yes. The
Why
awakening.
Why does the Lord have to do something dramatic about? When they tell me I have PTSD, I said, okay, so you're telling me that my brain wants to basically loop over and over and over about something that caused it, you know, like shocked it,
mm-hmm.
and made it want to... But when I went to a concert for the first time, LA Guns, it was such a beautiful, thrilling, shocking experience. How come I can't, like, go there? Why can't my brain be programmed to go to something sweet or amazing?
Sure.
Oh, that was the first time I saw Eric Faulkner of the Bay City Rollers. Oh! How about that one? I mean, how about a happy experience?
Yes.
How about the first time I saw my child being born? You know, why does it always have to be a nightmare?
Mm-hmm.
If you can be programmed into darkness, then hello, there's two sides to a coin.
Yes.
You cannot deny positivity. If you believe in death, then you believe in life.
Agreed.
If you believe in God, then you believe in the devil. If you believe in the devil, you believe in God. You can't have one without the other. And the number one lesson you can take away from this is that you can only serve one God. That's the thing. You truly, truly, truly can only be in one place at one time. Well, virtually you can be everywhere. But you only can serve one God at a time. And at the time in my life, I wasn't doing it yet, but I've kind of always lived my life that way. That the moment that I have naughty things or bad things happening to me, it's a foreshadow that I've been up to something that I shouldn't be up to.
Sure, I mean, we do that to ourselves. It's the choices we make. I think it's the choices we make.
Well, truth is crazier than fiction. What ended up actually being wrong with me, because we went through the Marriott, Crohn's, Brew, I mean, went through everything. 15 years after this illness and my being sick all the time and going into the hospital and finally being bedridden and then ending up in hospice. I mean, it was a journey. It did not happen overnight. 15 years later, and one of the doctors is already retired, Dr. Vandermeer, my surgeon. Five people on my GID, Dr. Pasolka, my consultant for my nutritionist. We have so many people. It's a burger, and thank you, Liz, for the Grammys. It's funny. But 15 years later, we found out what was wrong. I was being poisoned.
Wow. That's not even cool.
That's crazy.
It's really crazy. And just think how many people out there who's doing, you know, have this same pretty much effect, you know. I mean, my mother comes to mind. My mother comes to mind just due to what they have been particularly administrating and not really understanding what, you know, what they're giving her. And herself not doing the research, you know. It's crazy. I mean, that's really crazy.
Crazy to me is the things I learned while I was a patient, because my nutritionist would come to me and say, okay, well, they think you have Crohn's or SPRU or whatever, and they would have to change my diet constantly. Anybody who's ever been diagnosed knows, as soon as they're going in through your stomach, it's over. The worst testing, the worst everything. Your dignity goes out the window at that point. Everyone knows. And to come back from that, you can.
Yes.
You can. I was completely toxic. Every part of my body was being shut down, and we were attacking it like it was some sort of disease. We were going after it like, oh, it's in the breast. It's definitely in there. And then they were blasting me in, kicking out of bed. Anybody knows that but what was ended up happening was that he would come in and he would say, well, you have these levels of arsenic in your body, but life has arsenic. You know, when you were going to the whole list of these nine things that had, and I would go, what? What are you talking about? And then when they thought he had SPRU and Crohn's, they said I couldn't have any meat. And they said, oh, you're going to have a reaction to wheat. But there's wheat in ketchup. There's wheat in ranch dressing. You know, it was like, you expected meat in the bread.
Justification.
You expected meat. It's wheat, but I've never expected it in my salad dressing.
Sure.
And then it started making me have to, I not only had to read labels, I started having to really find out what was going inside my body.
Sure.
And what was affecting what. And I had to learn so, so much. So while everyone thinks I was sleeping, being in a coma, I was actually in a super, super educated state.
Yeah, that's cool.
I was completely being prepared, I guess, for the path ahead of me. And again, cannabis would play a role. Like, it would keep popping up in my life. Like a weed, she would keep popping up.
Yes.
And I would turn to her out of desperation and not realize that good night's sleep you got, the reason that you are calming down and not crying anymore, the reason that you stopped thinking, you know, bad things about you, it's cannabis. I never made the dot. I never connected those dots until it was staring me in the face. I made the trek all the way from Phoenix to Washington State, barely. I was less than 24 hours without tubes in me, and I'd had them for years. And the only thing sustaining me alive was that they were making me talk. Oh my goodness, they wouldn't stop, and they would blow on me, and they would have to have me eat, drink, and oh my god,
That's what time
they had cannabis suppository, she would have had to be one. They were trying to get it into my body every way that they could possibly think of, and they must have known something like it because it got me here. And then it was a very slow, very, very long path, but it all led me to here. It all led me to where I am today. I don't have a colostomy. I eat everything I want to eat. I'm very careful. I'm super careful. And I don't use margarine. Actually, it was banned in England. It was banned for making teenagers angry.
Interesting.
Isn't that interesting?
Yes.
And the level of plastic in margarine is so high. It's ridiculous.
Yes.
And I don't use I can't believe it's not better because I can't believe they're feeding that to us.
Yes.
I try to be as much organic, non-genetically modified, real food as humanly possible. I'm very super careful with my veggies and my fruits especially. Mm. And my cannabis. Yes. I make absolutely sure that it's organic. I make sure I know, you know, but more importantly, you have a lot to do with your healthcare.
Yes, you have a lot big to do time, big
you
time.
You become your own system
yes.
of care,
yes.
real care. And you, when you realize that a $12 plant, or however, you know, $12 basically, come on, $12, you can take back your life. Your life. I used to be rolled from side to side in a bed, and I was told that from laying there, oh my goodness, my muscles atrophied so badly, they wouldn't even let me get up and go to the nurse station. It was just a little queue outside of my room. It was so, I mean, it was just out there, but they wouldn't even let me do that. And I'm always feeling God, whatever you want to call it, my will to live came to me. I would spend every waking moment learning. The Hippocratic Oath says it's a promise. Doctor first, physician, you first, no harm.
Yes. Yes.
But it's backwards. First, and then they tell people that are going to live through the ones that aren't. But they don't do it through the ones that live. They do it through trials, the ones that are alive but dying.
Wow. So we get kind of getting to that hour mark. I wanted to kind of ask you, so are you currently still using White Widow? I know that's a big strain out here in these Washington parts and around the country, keep it real with you. But are you still using White Widow, or you prefer some other strain at this time in your life?
At this time, I call myself the Diva Sativa because I love Sativa. And I'm not familiar enough. Like I said, I am new to cannabis. And I am really, really, really novice about this. I'll be honest with you. My thumbs are just only mixed green. All my fingers are green. And my ears too. This is very new to me. And I truly am learning along with everyone else. I'm getting educated along with being a vegetarian.
Sure, sure.
And I'm wiggy-bigging too. I was a sheeple too, for sure. And I love the White Widow. I love the White Rhino. I love the White All of them.
Yeah, they're pretty good.
There's something about
strains,
them. They're pure strains. Yes. The Blue Dream.
Oh, that's on point.
OG.
That's on point.
But my favorites are the super fruity. I love your Pineapple Express. I love the really fruity topics.
Okay.
And I love head cheese. Head cheese I call social media. Because as much as I love to chit-chat and be social, it gives you that wonderful aphrodisiac effect. And we'll definitely talk about that sometime. People don't realize there is a strain for every pain, but there's also a strain for pretty much anywhere your imagination can go in a beautiful and lovely kind of way.
Yes.
There's a flower out there for
it. Yes. Agree with that. So what are, I know you have some products and services you offer per se. I would like to hear more about that, what you have going, because I know you have some some ointments you put on your body or different products you use, whatnot.
Yes.
Here's your opportunity.
I have a product called Mary Jane, and Mary Jane is a medicated, the concept was that I wear cosmetics and I'm a model, so I have to wear them all the time.
Okay.
But I'm always concerned about my skin, the way I look, and aging, and like any girl is.
Yes.
And I thought to myself, if this cosmetic was medicated, it would be good for me. And then I thought, out for a minute, I can hear you.
Oh, I'm right here. Hopefully everything is good.
And what I'm saying is, Mary Jane is edible. raw skin treatment, and it's made for women, men, and pets.
Oh, wow.
It's made for children, but it's really not really intended for them. But if you wanted it, it certainly could be. But this is more of a boutique item. I always wanted it to be targeted at a luxury item that you get in a spa. But it's also extremely beneficial. It can benefit anybody. And basically, it's medicated as a coconut oil base, which we now know has articles you can look up now that tell you that now that there's research being done, because medicated cannabis and coconut oil seems to be fighting cancer. Surprise,
yes.
Something that, by the way, they knew since the 1970s.
Yes.
Every single disease, including AIDS, that we ever, and cancer especially, and I've fought so many to cancer, and after being told that, you know, right after death, and then losing my beautiful breath because they did was they took such a big chunk out of one for testing that it basically deformed me, and then I lost all confidence. And women can relate to that.
Yes.
I did it again, and then because of the diet and soda, I was getting false breast testing, and they said, oh, that's so common. And I was like, what do you mean it's so common? You know about all of this. If you Google Chrome my daddy, because that really is my daddy, Google Chrome is going to tell you everything about me. Whether or not I wanted to, he's even got pictures.
Yes.
And if you Google Chrome him, you will be able to find out. Just put in there, research with cannabis and results. You'll be shocked and weep and outraged at the year that they knew about the research of cannabis.
For sure.
Elsie Musica, who's the fourth government patient ever to receive cannabis for her eyes, look up her story. She can tell you she was in a secret government study with medical marijuana for 20 years.
Mm.
Who knew medical marijuana was a term for 20 years? We thought we just said it.
Yeah, no doubt. You're right about that.
Yeah.
Right about
who knew the White Widow? White Widow had been around since Pipe Stick and Kona Gold. Who knew that? And remember Kona Gold and Pipe Stick? Way back in the day when Cheech and Chong ruled the rage, we were like thinking that people are all reefer madness and nonsense. Well, today you can get your medicine in many, many, many forms.
Yes.
And my idea was medical. Animal. It is so yummy. I can't. You have to taste it for yourself. But basically, I use organic sugar, which right there.
Okay.
And then organic coffee because I like that caffeine.
Okay.
And I scrub, and then I've got the medicated moisture as well. So I do two steps, but look at my skin. And that's all I have to say. And it's so yummy. You can eat it if you want to.
Yes.
You want nothing else to eat, you were trapped somewhere, you could eat it.
Yeah.
And it would medicate you as well. So, look, you all of them. And what I've got going on is I've got 420girlsnetwork.com.
Okay.
It is the umbrella, it is the green hive, if you will, of all the other entities. Chronic Magazine, which we all know I love so much. And it's got all the links for everything that I'm involved in, everybody else out there. I don't have time in the world to shout out to everybody.
Yeah, I know you.
And I thanks to everybody involved. And I want to talk to Sid and Haru. Thank you so much for having me.
I appreciate
you. And for listening to my story and sharing this time with me. Super important. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
So as we conclude, Consider wants to thank you for your time and support. For more information, tune in to www.considergroup.com, Facebook, Consider Group, Twitter, Consider Group, Instagram, Consider Group. It's all how we connect. Networking within a network.